This presentation demonstrates a practical application of the risk management portion of a safety management system. This example was contributed by Captain Robert Sumwalt, U.S. Airways, retired, member and former vice chair of the NTSB. It's based on an actual operation from a corporate flight department. A previously published FAA System Safety Handbook has the following quote that is particularly appropriate to problems regarding continuing operational safety and risk management. Risk management is not an additional task, something added on at the end. It is the way we perform our daily business. It's what we do in the operations and activities involved in providing products and services. Let's review and emphasize the key aspects of risk management. First, we have to have a firm grasp on the systems, the operations, and the operational environment that is involved. This allows us to identify potential hazards such as system problems, operational task difficulties, and the environmental conditions that could pose a risk to the organization. Now that the risk has been established, you can determine the likelihood and severity of that risk, thus allowing you to make an informed decision about risk acceptability and the need for risk controls. In the Appendix 1 of AC 12092, you can find the word description of the SRM process. The objective here is for you to become comfortable with the SRM process as a flow of decision-supporting and decision-making activities instead of just a list of requirements in which you check the blocks. The SRM workflow follows the five steps of any decision-making process. These steps are: Step 1, design and context. This is where the system analysis block fits, as it requires an understanding of the system and environment in which the system exists. Step 2, specific information. Hazard identification fits in this block. Here you gather specific information and facts to identify conditions that may represent a danger to your organization. Step 3, analysis. This is where you analyze the hazards and decide what risks they present to your operation. Step 4, risk assessment. This is the point in the process where a risk matrix may be used to determine the likelihood of the risk and how severe the consequences of that risk may be. Depending on the outcome of this assessment, the risk may be acceptable or unacceptable. If the risk is acceptable, you're finished and the information is transferred to the safety assurance workflow. If the risk is unacceptable, you move on to Step 5, action problem resolution. Here, corrective or preventative strategies are formulated to either eliminate the risk or mitigate it to an acceptable level. Once these controls are implemented, they are run back through the safety risk management workflow to ensure they accomplish their purpose without introducing additional risk. The SRM workflow starts with system analysis, which in turn starts with identifying the operational process, which is in Appendix 1 of the AC dash as amended. The level of detail is only that needed to identify reasonably foreseeable hazards or to address hazards already identified. In this case, the flight operations are being planned into the Hilton Head, South Carolina Airport. As the slide says, the operations are being conducted under 14 CFR Part 91 by a corporate flight department transporting company executives to business activities. The operations are being conducted in medium turbine airplanes by a professional air crew. From here, we'll go through a brief description and analysis of the system, the environment, and the operational tasks. This airport is in a coastal area on the east coast of the United States. The airport elevation is 19 feet above mean sea level, and there is open water immediately northeast of the airport. Now we'll take a look at the facilities of the airport. Here's the airport's single runway. It's 4,300 feet long, which is adequate for the aircraft used, but possibly marginal for operations at high weights, at night, or in low IFR conditions. The airport has a tower, but it's only operational during daytime and early evening hours. During night operations, pilot-controlled lighting is available. Now we continue to look into the airport's physical environment for anything that might affect the safety of arrivals and departures into and out of the airport. This could consist of many things, But for the purposes of this example, notice there are numerous trees mentioned in the departure procedures for this airport. For IFR operations, the Hilton Head Airport has only non-precision approaches. None use intermediate step-downs, and none have vertical guidance. The most accurate of these approaches, the localizer DME approach to runway 21, also requires radar to initiate the approach. Two of the approaches, and the only one that allows for a straight-in landing on runway 3, require operational, approach-capable, IFR-approved Global Positioning System GPS equipment with a current database. From our analysis of the system, the operations, and the environment, we identify two potential hazards. One, the lack of precision approach facilities, and two, the lack of an operational tower at night. We might have identified other hazards, but for the sake of the example, we'll stick with these two because it's not expected that companies will be able to address every conceivable hazard, but they are expected to exercise due diligence to identify and address reasonably foreseeable hazards. The expectation of the SMS is that companies need to have a method of documenting and tracking hazards and the actions taken. This can be paper, a simple computer file, or a sophisticated IT system, depending on the operator. On the surface, neither of these hazards represents an immediate no-go. In fact, many pilots will say that the airport has relatively good facilities and conditions for an experienced, competent crew. However, for routine operations, we want to look at making our risk as low as reasonably practical. In spite of the fact that operations into non-towered airports using non-precision approaches are conducted routinely, analysis conducted by the Flight Safety Foundation identifies these two conditions as being high on the list of risk factors for approach and landing accidents. This risk matrix developed by the company was used to evaluate the overall level of risk. This is part of the risk acceptance process established in the SMS that directs the organization to use tools for risk assessment. The policy section and the SRM component of the SMS also have expectations that the company define the levels of management who have the authority to accept risk. This makes it necessary that these individuals have at least a basic knowledge of the assessment tools and be proficient in the use of these tools. While not being in the highest likelihood category, the potential severity of an approach and landing accident places the risk at a higher level than the company was willing to accept. It's important to note that the hazards create the risk, but we're not assessing the hazards directly. We are assessing the likelihood and potential severity of a consequence, in this case, an approach and landing accident. The conclusion of the analysis is that the risk is unacceptably high given the conditions. Remember that risk management is a decision-making activity. Thus, there may be no absolute right or absolute wrong outcome of the analysis. The SRM process is a decision tool. That's another reason why the people who make operational decisions need to be involved in the process. The policy section of the SMS has an expectation for the organization to designate levels of management who are authorized to make these decisions. The next step is to develop risk controls. The first place to look is back at the hazards. What is it about the set of conditions that constitute the risk in these operations? Is there anything we can do to eliminate or mitigate one of these conditions, alter the operations, or make our people better able to cope with them? Be careful with risk-reward determination. It can easily get translated into a perception that high risk is acceptable if the reward of mission accomplishment is high. This can be especially problematic in emergency operations, such as an emergency medical transport, firefighting, law enforcement, or other situations where well-intentioned but misplaced priorities can lead people to accept inappropriate levels of risk. In our search for a mitigating strategy, we should consider the alternatives. The availability of practical alternatives may affect our choice of how to attack the problem. As in hazard identification, we need to consider changing the operation, changing an element of the system, changing how our people cope with the conditions, or how they operate equipment. In this case, a ready alternative presents itself. If we need to avoid the Hilton Head Airport, the Savannah International Airport with precision approach facilities, tower and approach control facilities is within a reasonable distance. So we decided to control the effects of the two hazards that we've identified by limiting operation in two ways. One, restrict operations to hours when the tower is open. This will assure that the pilots have real-time weather, runway conditions, and facility operational information. Two, restrict operations when the weather is low IFR. Even though the ceiling of 800 feet and the visibility of 2 miles, as stated, are above legal limits, this company's standard provides a higher safety margin. As noted earlier, we can use Savannah as an alternate destination, determine another alternate with similar facilities, or delay the operation. In the end, we've chosen to change our operations during the conditions of night or low IFR. A subtle nuance to this analysis is that we have actually already determined that the risk of day VFR or other than low IFR conditions is acceptable. If we had decided, for instance, that the primary hazard was the runway length, our decision might have been to avoid this airport entirely. The final check on the risk control is to reassess the risk under the new condition with the risk control in place. While there's still a degree of risk with any aviation operation, it can be concluded that the controls will reduce the risk level. At this point, we need to make sure that we, number one, document the outcome in whatever hazard tracking system is employed. Number two, monitor the performance and effectiveness of the risk controls. And number three, communicate these controls to the employees involved in the operations. The necessity for a feedback loop between SRM and subsequent assurance activities is also defined in the SMS. As you can see, even before their famous flight of December 17, 1903, the Wright brothers recognized the need for risk management. This quote from Wilbur Wright, written 2 years earlier, exemplifies the Wrights' attitude. It's clear that their attitude toward risk management was a key element in their ultimate success. We trust this presentation has been helpful in explaining the principles of safety risk management. However, if you have any other questions or need further assistance, please contact the SMS program office